from Las Vegas, An Evening with Jerry Lewis.
For this nonsense. Sit down and relax. We're gonna have some fun here tonight. Everybody here has been so wonderful. Managing director of the hotel comes to me during the rehearsal and he said, I want you to know something very important. He said, this is not my hotel, this is not your hotel, this is our hotel. I said, let's sell it. So I go to Miami to see my uncle. And he's in his apartment with his friend, and they're playing chess. And I hope it's one of ours. They're playing chess, and he says to his friend, you know, I got so annoyed with forgetting. I got so embarrassed being told, yeah, we knew that. He said, I had to go to a specialist because the hearing was awful. Oh, you went to a specialist? Oh, yes. And he gave me whatever the hell it is, and it's making things better. His friend said, well, what was it? He said, you know that long flower with the thorns on it? The friend said, rose. He said, that's it. Rose, what's the name of the medicine the doctor gave me? This old man is in the middle of Central Park, and he is sobbing like a child. A police officer walks by. He says to him, sir, can I be of any assistance? Can I help you in any way? The old man said, no, thanks, officer. I appreciate it. But you see, my wife died a couple of years ago, and shortly thereafter, I met this lovely Swedish young girl, 27 years old, and we got together, and we got a place. And for the last 2 years, I've had the wildest and most exciting sex that you could ever believe possible. The police officer said, then why are you crying? He said, I forgot where we live.
And Dad, what will your friends do?
Friends may forsake me.
And what will you let them do to you?
Let them all forsake me.
And who will you still have? In the end?
I still have you.
You're a fancy singer, boy.
And I love you so.
What's my name?
Sonny
Boy.
Martin and Lewis came along around 45, 46. And the world had just gone through a rough war. And people needed to communicate with one another. I was playing the 500 Club in Atlantic City on Missouri Avenue. And the singer on the show, he lost his voice. Skinny comes to me and says, do you know anybody that can fill that spot in the show? I said, well, My friend Dean Martin just closed in Chicago. He's not working. He's in New York. He said, well, we're thinking about maybe not another singer. I said, he's just not another singer. I mean, we do things together that are really funny. He said, okay, I'll bring him in. I was in my dressing room, and Skinny comes back and says, we were looking for what you told us would happen between you and your friend. None of that ever happened. So we're just advising you that if it doesn't happen in the next show, then the two of you can look for work somewhere. I said, let's just do this. We had set out for pastrami sandwiches at the deli down the block, and I took the brown bag that they came in, ripped it in half, took a makeup pencil, and I started to list little shticks that I remember from burlesque and my dad, and he didn't miss a beat. We were out there over 2 hours, and it was glorious. Skinny comes backstage. He said that was great. The word of mouth was catching on. The next night, we couldn't get into the club. We did 8 shows a day. First show was at 10:10 in the morning. The last show was at 12:40 in the next morning.
I'm singing in the rain. I just singing in the rain. What a glorious feeling. I'm happy again. I'm singing.
Performer that cares about his audience has a different audience than normally. They fall in love with you because they see you care for them and that you sweat your head off to do the best work you can do. Dean, of course, had no knowledge of theatrical or show business, but when he came to sit with me to hear what I was going to do while he was singing, he was smiling and he was enjoying it. And then, of course, he learned that when I went out to do it, it was a little different than I told him it would be. And it was because I loved working off the top of my head. And we built the act in those first 2 weeks. And we were getting $125 a piece. And in less than 6 weeks, we were getting $10,000. Then, of course, when we went into the Copa, the word of mouth there was much, much more than it was in Atlantic City. The fact that we were booked in the Copa was that was success in itself. And the reason it was so wonderful was because we were so enamored by what we were doing.
I hope that everything's all right. And in the event you want to see us, we are available for bar mitzvahs and weddings.
We were so proud to believe that an audience will stand up in the middle of an act in a nightclub when you got Joey Gatto in the front and Ralph Tiddarati over there and Scungil down there. We had some really heavy hitters, boy. Oh, I used that, right. I don't need that anymore. We'd like you to see something that we call all legs.
Show them how to do it. Yeah, like this, everybody. Ready? Go. They told me this is very good. Yeah, now we'll do another one. Okay, that's enough of that one. Let's... No, that... All right, that's all for this one. Stop. One, two. Now, if we... All right. Hold. One, two. Stop. Now...
The Colgate Comedy Hour gave us the greatest audience that you could ever get because Sunday night was becoming a very strong viewing night.
I'm not gonna do it!
And when we went on Colgate, we were the only ones that ever beat Sullivan. He said, what do I do about this? And I said, don't worry about it. I'll say a few things while we're on the air that'll put you off the air so it'll be over. Don't worry about it. He said, no, you can't do that. I said, I can do anything I want, and I usually do, as long as it's to entertain the people.
Amazing at the way that you push those things up there. It must take a great deal of patience.
And a little muscle.
I would really enjoy trying that sometime.
I don't think you'd have the patience for it.
Well, I have the other thing you mentioned, the little muscle. I say that was sort of a corker.
Here, enjoy yourself.
I suspect it was somewhat heavier than I...
From a lovely film that I really enjoyed being part of, The Nutty Professor, we do That Old Black Magic. That old black magic has me in its spell. That old black magic that you weave so well. Those icy fingers up and down my spine. The same old witchcraft when your eyes meet mine. The same old tingle that I feel inside. And then that elevator starts its ride. And down I go. Round and round I go, like a leaf that's caught in a tide. I should stay away, but what can I do? I hear your name, and I'm aflame.
flame with such a burning desire that only your kiss can put out that fire. For you're the lover I have waited for, the mate that fate had me created for. And every time your lips meet mine, darling, down, down, down I go. Round and round I go in a spin, loving the spin I'm in under that old black magic called love. For you're the lover I've waited for, you're the mate that fate had me created for. And every time your lips meet mine, darling, down, down, down I go. Round and round I go in a spin, loving the spin I'm in under that old black magic called love. In a spin, loving the spin I'm in under that old black magic called love. In a spin, loving the spin I'm in under that old
Thank you. Oh, wow. I think we can all agree that Jerry Lewis has had such a tremendous impact on comedy in America. And it's clear he still cares so much about doing everything he can to entertain his audience. And right now, that audience is you. Hello, I'm Judy Ann Price, and we have so much more hilarious and memorable Jerry Lewis moments to share with you. But right now, we're asking you to call the number on your screen to help raise the funds this public television station needs to give you the best seat in the house to watch and enjoy America's best performers like Jerry Lewis. And now I'd like to introduce my good friend, Rudy Casillas.
He's good, huh? You're a delightful audience, and I appreciate it very much.
We love you.
What?
We love you.
There'll be no soliciting here, lady. You know what mixed emotions are? Mixed emotions is a man watching his mother-in-law drive off a cliff in his new Lincoln Continental. The cannibals are having dinner, and the one cannibal says, "I hate my mother-in-law." And the other one said, "Then just eat the rice." It's a musician's joke. My impression of a gentleman had a little too much to drink. Same drunk in an earthquake. When Johnny Carson called me in 1983, he asked me to take over The Tonight Show. I said, yeah, I'd love to do it. So I went to New York for 6 weeks and did The Tonight Show. Ed McMahon told me about beginning announcers coming to New York. If they want to be an announcer on television, they have to do an announcer's test. They have to pass that test. Now, the test involves memory, enunciation, pronunciation, and completion. And I would like to do that test for you now, if I can. One hen, two ducks, three squawking geese, four limerick oysters, five corpulent porpoises, six pairs of dinovazos tweezers, 7,000 Macedonians in full battle array, eight brass monkeys from the ancient sacred crypts of Egypt, nine apathetic, sympathetic, diabetic old men on roller skates with a marked propensity towards procrastination and sloth, 10 lyrical, spherical, diabolical denizens of the deep who haul stall around the corner of the quibby all at the same time. I love to run this clip because my partner was in it. And I want you to see how I disturbed his entire life. Go ahead, put the wedding clip up.
Did the bellhop upset you?
Oh, it really doesn't matter, darling. Yeah. He'll be gone in a moment.
Yeah, then we'll be all alone.
Uh-huh.
Boy, this Holloway goes pretty good, don't it? I don't fool around.
Look, buddy, will you do me a favor? Give me a break. I just got married.
You what?
I'm on my honeymoon. I just got married. Give me a break.
Newlyweds?
No, olderlyweds. Yeah, newlyweds.
Oh, that is magnificent. May I be very first to congratulate you and wish you the very best of luck. Thanks. And is that the little woman over there?
Yeah,
well, congratulations.
Uh-huh. I'll teach you to kiss my wife.
I don't need no lessons.
Oh, come on, buddy. Only been married an hour.
Oh, you were married today?
Today.
I want to wish you the very best of luck. And to the little woman.
I am here.
Oh, well, do you want me to kiss you?
You have to know what you're doing before you can break the rules. And breaking the rules sometimes can be much, much more creative than what you had prepared for. So we get excited about doing ridiculous stuff that worked. And we left it in. We were having more fun than any audience ever had. 10 years to the day. Dean and I teamed up on July 25th, 1946, and we split up July 25th, 1956.
Listen. I have a friend who loves what you do every year. And who just wanted to come out. Would you send my friend out, please? Okay, where is he? Will you send him out here? Come here. Break it up. I think it's about time, don't you?
And thank you.
Yeah, I think it's about time. Ready up, folks.
I don't know.
So how you been?
You know, it seems like we haven't seen each other for 20 years.
Yeah. Well, you know, there was all those rumors about our breaking up, and then when I started the show and you weren't here, I believed it.
I'll show you guys to your room if you like. The lights are out upstairs, so follow me if you want.
Well, he drinks a lot, this kid.
So you're working?
Now for a bit of humanity. That happened on September the 4th, 1976. My partner and I didn't talk for 20 years. The stupidity of that I cannot expound on. The ignorance of that is something I hope I'll always forget. But we did indeed meet that night because of Frank. And then we spoke every day after that. I miss him a great deal, and I don't have a problem saying that. People fear emotions, I have found over the years, and emotions are wonderful. It gets stuff out that shouldn't be stuck in here forever. And it's a good thing to do. There's not enough people telling their friends that they care a lot. You got to do that, and you'll have that friend for a long time. And I didn't mean to be a preacher tonight, but it's tough to look at stuff with my partner and myself and not be affected by it. And that's all this is, being affected by working with him again, though he's up there and I'm down here. But we are working together. From the film Cinderfella, I dedicate this song, usually, to my wife. She's not always with me. She's taking care of my daughter, or the house, or whatever, but when we are together, it's extraordinary. I dedicate it to my Sam, probably more deeply tonight than ever before. She's kept me alive. She made sure that the 6 or 7 hospital visits I had been in would never happen again. So my gratitude to her is deep and comes from a place we don't even understand. But there are people here in this audience that love like that and that have partners that give them love like that. And for all of those people, I dedicate this song from Cinderfella. Everybody needs to care for somebody. All your dreams were meant to share with somebody. Someone to have a midnight cup of tea with, to have and hold, and sometimes disagree with. Oh, it's wonderful to live for somebody. And the most you have to give is your love in a cabin or a castle. Even though you rise or fall, without somebody, you're nobody at all. Oh, it's wonderful to live for somebody. And the most you have to give is your love in a cabin or a castle, even though you rise or fall. Without somebody, you're nobody at home. Nice, Benny. Nice.
makes great comedy? The desire to give people pleasure. That's it. There's no more to it. There's no less to it. Stan Laurel was the most brilliant, because he created everything that Stan and Ollie did. And the dichotomy here was, Ollie was everything Dean was, and Stan was everything I was. And I would sit with him for hours and hear him tell me something that they did, and I remember we did it. And more and more and more. And what that was not coincidence. It was all provoked by the same emotion. Love. Stan loved Ollie like no one could ever be loved. And vice versa. And it was a love affair. And love was the basis of their comedy. They loved to watch one another fall down. They loved to watch one another screw up. And that was magic for them. And we were the recipients of all of this pleasure. And for the last 4 years of Stan's life, I was at his apartment in Santa Monica maybe 20 times a year until he died. He taught me more with one statement that I call on whenever I create anything. He said, never forget, Jerry, or he called me Lad. Lad, never forget. The rule of three is vital for comedy. I said, the rule of three. Yeah. He said, you must tell an audience you're gonna do something. Then do it. But be sure to tell them it's been done. Is that simple? It's simple until you have to apply it.
Okay, that was brilliant. That typewriter scene is just genius. And what a fun way to see some of Jerry Lewis's best comedic moments. That's one of my favorite. You know, he's done so much, and the kind words and the tribute that Jerry gave to his comedy partner, the late Dean Martin, and his wife, it was so nice. Sandy, were truly touching. That song, it just proved that Jerry is not only a master of laughter, but has a huge heart. Hi, everyone. I'm Judy Ann Price. And if you just joined us, we're watching the incomparable Jerry Lewis in this fantastic look back at his incredible career. We are delighted to bring you this new Jerry Lewis program, and there's so much more still to come. So I hope you'll stay with us during this brief intermission so that we can tell you about some of the exciting ways you can enjoy Jerry Lewis beyond this PBS program. So let's take a look.
The incomparable Jerry Lewis celebrates more than 65 years of refining the art of slapstick humor in his very first PBS special. And now, you can laugh your way through the films that made him one of America's favorite comedians. When you donate $60 to this public television station, we'll thank you with the DVD of the classic 1965 film, The Family Jewels. In this film that Jerry Lewis directed and co-wrote, a young heiress must choose among six uncles, one of whom is up to no good and out to harm the girl's beloved bodyguard who practically raised her. Lewis plays all six uncles and the bodyguard. And for the ultimate Jerry Lewis experience, for a donation of $100 to this podcast, Morty S. Tashman innocently manages to leave a Hollywood entertainment company in complete shambles through a series of hilarious shenanigans and escapades, as well as the riotously funny 1963 film, The Nutty Professor, which set a new standard for screen comedy and inspired the hit remake. Whichever gift you choose, do your part now and help preserve public television's legacy of quality programming for you, your family, and your entire community.
Now, who wouldn't want to have those classic Jerry Lewis films as part of their collection? Hi, I'm Rudy Casillas, and I'm here to invite you to become a member of this public television station. Your contribution is welcome in any amount, large or small. Please, make an investment in this station right now, because where else do you see shows like this on television? Nowhere except this station. So if you want to keep enjoying great programs like this one throughout the year, call the number on your screen with your donation or go online to help keep this station strong for our entire community.
And just remember, whatever dollar amount you are able to give helps the station so much. And this is the money that we use to purchase new episodes of your favorite programs so that you can enjoy them throughout the entire year. We hope you'll support this station with whatever amount is comfortable, whatever amount makes you feel like it's a good thing. And it fits your budget. So please make your pledge right now of support. Call the number on your screen or pledge online right now.
That's right, Judy Ann. Every donation really does make a difference. So we hope you will call the number on your screen and see how you can make a difference right now. There are so many programs on public television to watch, and this station uses your donations to pay for them each year. So if you love what you watch on public television and you want to enjoy another year of inspiring comedy, music, news, cooking, history, Antiques Roadshow, Downton Abbey, Nature, Nova, all your public television favorites, then please do your part and give whatever amount you can afford. And while we're at it, let's take another look at how you can continue to enjoy Jerry Lewis beyond this wonderful program.
Enjoy Jerry Lewis beyond his first PBS special with exciting thank you gifts. For a donation of $60, we'll show our appreciation with The Family Jewels on DVD. In this 99-minute 1965 classic, the multifaceted and talented Jerry Lewis plays all six uncles that a suddenly orphaned 9-year-old heiress must choose from. And for a donation of $100 to this public television station, we'll thank you with The Family Jewels, along with the 92-minute DVD of The Errand Boy, in which Jerry Lewis, as Morty S. Tashman, is hired to be the eyes and ears of a Hollywood mogul at Paramutual Pictures. Lights, camera, calamity. Your $100 gift will also include the 107-minute original 1963 classic, The Nutty Professor, that Jerry Lewis directed, co-wrote, and starred in. In it, he plays a timid, nearsighted chemistry teacher who discovers a magical potion that can transform him into a suave and handsome Romeo. The Jekyll and Hyde game works well enough until the concoction starts to wear off at the most embarrassing times, and the professor begins to suffer hilarious symptoms of his personality split. Altogether, that's our gift to you of three classic Jerry Lewis movies when you support this station with a $100 donation. Whichever gift you choose, you will be sure to enjoy the best of Jerry Lewis for years to come. And your financial support will bring you more great programs on this station.
I love this. I'm a huge Jerry Lewis fan, and you know, many of us forget that in addition to being a tremendous comedian, Jerry Lewis is an actor, a singer, a film producer, screenwriter, and film director. And the reason why so many of us and his films are so fantastic is because he directed them, and we think he's great. He co-wrote them, or both. This man truly has a gift for comedy, and his greatest gift to all of us is providing us with programs like this one and his wonderful films. We can remember them and enjoy them for years to come. Plus, when you donate to receive these classic films, you are helping to support this station and the public television programs you watch. It's truly a win-win, right, Rudy?
That's right. You know, your station uses your donations to pay for and air great programs like this one so that you can enjoy them right in your own home.
Television over the years has been known to change the minds of the audience. I have to watch quality television. And that's why it's important to do good stuff. Television is supposed to be an entertainment form. It is supposed to be entertaining. And I'm very proud to be part of anything that PBS does.
Well, you've certainly entertained us. Thank you so much. And if you're enjoying Jerry Lewis's hilarious and memorable comedy and remembering just how truly special he is, please consider donating to this public television station. That way, we can pay tribute to even more of the great men like Jerry Lewis and women who have enriched and inspired our lives. Your support not only will fund programs like this one that you're watching and enjoying right now, but also the educational children's programs, the news and public affairs shows, and everything else you love to watch right here. We hope to share these experiences. We can't do it without your contribution. So please give now, because your contribution at any amount, makes a difference. Or you could donate at one of our suggested levels, and we'll thank you with more wonderful ways to laugh with Jerry Lewis. You just say his name and you laugh. Take a look.
The incomparable Jerry Lewis celebrates more than 65 years of refining the art of slapstick humor in his very first PBS special. And now, you can laugh your way through the films that made him one of America's favorite comedians. When you donate $60 to this public television station, we'll thank you with the DVD of the classic 1965 film, The Family Jewels. In this film that Jerry Lewis directed and co-wrote, a young heiress must choose among six uncles, one of whom is up to no good and out to harm the girl's beloved bodyguard who practically raised her. Lewis plays all six uncles and the bodyguard. And for the ultimate Jerry Lewis experience, for a donation of $100 to this public television station, we'll thank you with three Jerry Lewis classic films on DVD. In addition to The Family Jewels, you will receive the 1961 Errand Boy, in which Jerry Lewis, as Morty S. Tashman, innocently manages to leave a Hollywood entertainment company in complete shambles through a series of hilarious shenanigans and escapades, as well as the riotously funny 1963 film, The Nutty Professor, which set a new standard for screen comedy.
These are terrific examples of Jerry Lewis's unique and quintessential comedic style. He is truly a physical comedian and to this day still cares so much about entertaining his audience. And right now, that audience, of course, is you. We would love to show our appreciation for your financial contribution with these memorable movies so that you have a piece of this comedic genius to enjoy and share with family and friends. So please call right now. There's a call right there, or you can pledge online.
And we're inviting you to join with us in our mission to bring you the programs, the quality programs you believe in and you love to watch. And when you do, you'll enjoy the finale of this Jerry Lewis comedy special even more. You're going to see some surprise guests. I know who they are. I'm not going to tell you. It's so exciting. It's a very special Q&A with the audience, who he loves, and there's so much more. It's all coming up here for you right here on this PBS station. And now it's going to be time for fun and laughter. But you know the point I like that we were watching was the point that Frank Sinatra came in and he brought Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis together on the stage. Did you get goosebumps? I hear people say they remembered when that happened. And then I hear them say that they still cry. I cried when it happened because it's such an emotional 20 years that went by and it was just a love fest. This is some of the stuff you can expect to see when you watch. And you know, this is incredible because it's only here on this PBS station that you can expect quality programs. And tonight, it's a great night to laugh. Everybody laugh when you watch specials like this. And even just seeing Jerry Lewis, just his face, I start to giggle. And you know, it makes you feel good. So if you want to feel good, call the number on your screen, and we're going to say thank you so much. But right now, sit back and watch the one and only Jerry Lewis.
Now, we have microphones in the audience, in the aisles, and I would love to do a Q&A with this audience because you sound perfect, and we could have a great deal of fun. Okay. Oh, how do you do? How are you?
Good evening, Mr. Lewis.
Good evening.
Why are your pantomime routines so funny today as they were the first time you did them?
I think that's a compliment to the audience. Audiences are responding to stuff that we did for years, but they're enjoying themselves, and that's what moves material along. It'll be done and done again, and I'm very proud of some of the people that have taken my work and reproduced it and brought it to today's generation. Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Steve Lawrence. I'm from
Steve Lawrence, son of a gun. Look at that. That's Steve Lawrence here with us.
Anyway, my question was to you, Mr. Lewis. You have been in this business for a long time.
Let me remind you, I'm going to be 87. I'd appreciate it if you move it along.
I'd appreciate it if 87, you'd move it along. However.
Yes.
I just want to know, you are involved not only in comedy, but you are the most musical comedian that I have ever been exposed to. And I just want to know, who is your favorite singer? Now, careful before you answer this. I don't want any names that are older than me.
Methuselah.
Wrong.
Wrong. Stevie.
Yes, darling.
Let me tell you this.
Yes.
We all love Frank.
Yes.
And I loved Frank as much as you did.
Yes.
And whenever Frank and I were together, and we would talk about the best vocalist in our entire business, Frank always said Steve Lawrence. Always. Always. And
now,
when he would say that, I tried desperately to tell him about Jerry Vale and
you putz. I didn't think you'd say that.
Steve Lawrence, ladies and gentlemen, that's a guest.
Yes. When I was a kid, I dreamed to be you.
You what?
I dreamed to be you. In my mirror, I was you. That's it.
Did you work anywhere?
Yeah. And after all, I became a Brazilian comedian, and I have my own show, and I'm here to ask you, how can I thank you? Do you want a hug, or do you prefer in cash?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, Jerry. We were having a discussion earlier tonight, and it was brought up that you actually were in a ring and fought with Marciano in 1952. Is that true?
Yep. And Rocky Marciano was one of my dearest friends until he hit me like that in the first round, and I just stared at him for three more minutes, and I said, I got some friends, Rocky. The audience loved seeing it because he just tapped me. That didn't mean anything. But because it was him, I thought my body was broken.
Fight night in Hollywood. And here's the champion, Rocky Marciano, the undefeated Brockton blockbuster. And in this corner, Jerry Lewis. The referee is Dean Martin.
Now look, you go to your corners, and when the bell rings, if you're smart, you won't come out. All right, shake hands and come out fighting.
Yes.
First of all, Jerry, you look absolutely fantastic. You look amazing.
Thank you.
Where did you get those red shoes? They're beautiful.
These shoes were given to me by a special man when Time magazine 4 years ago listed the 10 most recognizable people in the world. Number one was Muhammad Ali. Number two was Margaret Thatcher. Number three was Teresa, Sister Teresa. And number four was the Pope and Jerry Lewis tied. And he gave me those shoes. The Pope. He gave me them. Okay, right there.
Good evening, Mr. Lewis.
Good evening.
I was wondering if you could share with us what Charlie Chaplin said to you regarding your film, The Bellboy.
Well, I've tried to make it brief, but I was Charlie's guest at his home in Lucerne, Switzerland. And when I was ready to leave, Charlie said to me, you know, whenever people come to our home, we like to give them a souvenir of the visit. And I said, that's wonderful, Charlie. He said, but I want to be sure that what I give you, you will use and enjoy. I said, okay. And he said, what film of mine is that? I said, Modern Times. And he called New York, a negative was drawn, the print was made, and it was at my home in Bel Air when I got back from Switzerland. And Charlie, I called Charlie to say, I'm out of my mind in joy having this gift from you, Charlie. He said, well, I believe in whatever is fair for the next guy, and I would love to have my favorite film of yours, The Bellboy. I called New York and did the same thing and had it at his home in 4 days. I've never run Modern Times from the print he sent me because I want that for my children and my grandchildren. So I never run it, but I got it in the same tin can he sent it to me. And on the can is this tag that says, "To Jerry from your pal, Charlie." Oh. Thank you. Yes.
I wanted to thank you, first of all, for, you know, with all the
energy. Did you stick your finger in a light socket?
I did. I did, sir. With you and Dean doing all your skits, how many of them were improv and how much was it scripted?
I would say 45% of what we did was locked. But locked. You can't ask people to pay you what they paid us and walk out there and just wing it. So the 45% was to protect the integrity of the work, and 50 or 55% was right off the top of our heads most of the time. I wish you a lot of luck. Yes, sir.
Evening, sir. Thank you for your talents. My question is this. I read somewhere that you knew John F. Kennedy, and could I ask you to tell me one thing about the man?
Sure.
Thank you.
If God wanted all of us to see what he considered a perfect specimen, he would point to John Kennedy. I want to clarify something, because the Kennedys were my dear friends. And all through the years, people keep coming to me about Marilyn Monroe and John, Marilyn Monroe and Bobby Kennedy. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. These are two men of great intelligence, of great integrity. And they would never have ever been a part of anything like that because they loved her. She was a wonderful gal. Now, I know what I'm talking about because I was making it with her.
I love you, Jerry. Just a minute.
Okay, yes, sir.
Hello, Jerry.
This is Tim Conway.
Oh. Oh. Please. Oh, my God.
Let him, Tim. Let him.
Thank you so much. Oh, my God. If you could pass your wallets down to the center aisle, please. Thank you, sir. I have been a long-time admirer of yours. I can't tell you how far back it goes. I can tell you. It's a long time. But you were the one who inspired me to get into this business of raising horses. And... Yes, it is. But thank you so much for all of the wonderful things that, and the laughs that you have brought all of these people in this audience so much. And thank you, Jerry, for all the many laughs that you have given us through life. And I will cherish them as long as I live, which is about an hour from now.
Tim.
Thank you. Yes.
Tim, give me this moment, please.
Yes.
Just a moment.
Too long. Okay. Yes.
I went to the comedy festival in Montreal.
Yes.
I was asked to please name my favorite physical comedian.
Mm.
I said, not only is it Tim Conway, but... You have to recognize that the sketch that he did with Harvey Korman when he was the dentist.
Ah.
Tim, you have to recognize, you must recognize that there are those of us who are inspired by you.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Did you say goodness gracious?
Goodness gracious. Thank you so much for all. If you had said anything else, I would have said, I never liked him. But thank you so much for all of the things that you have brought to me and all the things I have brought to anybody. And if, please, just pass a couple of bucks down to the aisle as we leave. Thank you. You are the best. There's
thank you, no Tim. Question. Thank you so much for coming. Tim Conway, ladies and gentlemen. Wasn't that nice? That was really nice. And all of you were wonderful tonight, so let me do that. I thank you so much. All right.
I was born in a trunk. That was my education. From 5 years old till now, that was my education. And I learned it from a master. See, a lot of people talk their creative juices. I don't believe in talking about it. I believe in doing it. I had an idea one day, and I always have canes around because the eye and the hand are so vital to what I do. Because though it looks simple, it's physical. And if it's physical, let me at it. Give it to me if it's physical.
How are you? Here you are, Stanley. Get everything out of the trunk.
Young man, let me have the stool. This is something that I really loved. And thank you.
Philosophy on life, keep negative out of your system, don't talk negative, don't think negative, and think positive. Because the thought process in a human being travels a long way if the idea is substantial, if the idea is good for everyone.
For once in my life, I have someone who needs me. Someone I needed so long. For once unafraid, I can go where life leads me. And somehow I know I'll be strong. For once I can touch what my heart used to dream of long before I knew someone warm like you, Sam, would make my dream come true. For once in my life, I won't let sorrow hurt me. Not like it's hurt me before. For once I have something I know won't desert me. I'm not alone anymore. For once I can say this is mine. You can take it. Once I can feel I can make it, for once I can feel somebody's heard my plea.